So we're now going to hand over to Salman Khan of Toronto Global, and he's going to give us an introduction to Toronto and the FinTech ecosystem here in the city. So I'd ask Salman to join me with his video, and we will go from there. Next slide, please.
All right, thank you, Michael. Thanks for the invite here. Good morning, good afternoon, everyone. Next slide, please. My name is Salman Khan. I'm a senior advisor at Toronto Global. Toronto Global is a government-funded organization. We're funded by all three levels of government. And our mandate really is to help international companies expand into the Toronto region. We've helped numerous companies from Europe, primarily from the UK, expand and set up in Toronto across several sectors, whether it's FinTech, software as a service, business services, you name it. There's been quite a variety of investment coming this way across the pond. In terms of the services we provide, we help our companies understand the industry and the market in the Toronto region and Canada. And generally, we provide benchmarking analysis to compare operational costs for doing business in the Toronto region compared to, many other Canadian and American jurisdictions. One of the things that, is really popular with the CEOs and decision makers that I work with is salary comparisons. And, you can tell they're often, taken aback by the difference in salaries. I think when you talk about engineers or business development managers, and when you add on the foreign exchange costs, it makes it an even bigger impact. We provide advice and guidance on the steps required to set up a business, incorporation, accounting, taxes, immigration. We help companies find office space, based on their needs. Of course, during COVID, that's less of a need, but it's certainly something that we can help with. And then there's connections to industry experts, to other companies who have done what you're trying to do, local resources, professional services. So what we're really here are a one-stop shop for companies that are looking to explore expansion into Canada. And one of the things that I've noticed over the 4 or 5 years I've been doing this is, we are now pitching Toronto not as a Canadian hub, but more of a North American hub. And there are many reasons to do that, which I'll get into going forward. Next slide, please. So this is a map of the Toronto region. We are one of the largest and fastest growing metropolitan regions in North America. Today, the population in the region is about 7 million. By 2041, it's expected to grow to nearly 10 million people. If you look at the map, the city of Toronto in the middle at the bottom, that's about 3 million people just in the city of Toronto. And not many people realize it, but between the US and Canada, this is the third largest city in terms of population. The suburbs surrounding the city of Toronto has about 4 million people. So it's a really large population when it comes to market size, or when it comes to talent availability. Next slide, please. This is where we lie from a North American geographic context. We're in a prime location, which provides businesses with excellent North American and international market access. A market access of about 130 million people within a 500-mile radius. New York, Chicago, Boston, and Washington, are all less than 90 minutes away. Multiple daily flights, during normal times from Pearson Airport, which is just outside of the city, but also from the Island Airport, which is right downtown Toronto, makes it really convenient for traveling business people. If you think about the province of Ontario, which is the state equivalent in Canada, Ontario is the province in which the Toronto region lies, and that would be the fifth largest state in the U.S. if it was compared to the states in the U.S. Next slide, please. We are Canada's economic center. The Toronto region economy represents about 20% of Canada's GDP, greater share than any other metro region or province. We are home to just under 40% of Canada's head offices and Canadian locations for nearly half of Fortune 500 companies. Next slide, please. Thank you. Canada has 14 trade agreements with 51 countries, providing access to 1.5 billion consumers and 9.3 trillion in combined GDP. Our most recent trade agreements with CETA within Europe and then CPTPP with 11 countries across the Pacific have added over $200 billion worth of market access for businesses beyond just the USMCA and US and Mexico. Next slide. Thank you. So just to give you a little bit of a sense of the financial services sector in the Toronto region, we are the second largest financial services sector in North America and one of the fastest growing. Canada is internationally recognized as, you know, a sound investment and safe place to do business. I'm sure you will hear about that with the rest of the panel later today. We rank second for foreign direct investment confidence thanks to our transparent regulations and low business costs. Companies that, you know, Canada's five largest banks have their headquarters in Toronto. You will hear from some of them today. We have the 41 foreign bank head offices. HSBC has a large presence here. Nine of the 10 Canadian mutual fund managers have their HQ in Toronto. I'm sure you would have heard of, you know, Canada's pension funds, OMERS, OTPP, CPPIB, you know, have their HQ all in Toronto. So we're a great place when it comes to, you know, having access to these sort of institutions. Next slide, please, Barry. Thank you. This is just to sort of to give you a sense of, you know, who are the major players here. You've got all the Canadian banks here, RBC, Scotiabank, TD, BMO, CIBC, but you also have, you know, ICICI Bank, Citibank with large presences here. In terms of insurance, you have Manulife, Sun Life, Allstate, Aviva. And of course, you know, upcoming, not just upcoming because they've made it, companies like, you know, Borrowell and Wealthsimple and Shopify all have significant operations in the Toronto region. Next slide, please. So let's dig into a little bit on the FinTech ecosystem here. You know, we are obviously Canada's financial capital. And the second largest financial services center in North America. And at the same time, we're also the largest tech hub in Canada and the fifth largest in North America with about 24,000 companies employing just under 300,000 people. So we're really at the intersection of finance and technology, and there's no other place for, you know, for a fintech ecosystem to really flourish. We've twice been named the fastest growing tech center by CBRE, thanks to our strong universities, our colleges, the thriving startup scene, the incubators, accelerators, and billions of dollars worth of investment from global tech leaders like Google, Shopify, and Amazon. There's also a wide network of Canadian and global financial institutions collaborating with the fintechs in the Toronto region to provide new solutions for banking customers. And you'll hear from, you know, folks like you from BMO later today on the partnership side of the kind of great work that they're doing in terms of building those relationships with fintechs. Next slide, please. Thank you. This is just to give you a sense of, you know, what the breakdown of the fintech you know, players looks like. As you can imagine, payments makes up the biggest part of, you know, the different subsectors within financial, within fintech, but you really do get a full spectrum of major financial services offerings here in Toronto. Companies like Shopify and Wealthsimple are just prime examples of venture-backed and, you know, leading Canadian fintech companies that have made it to the international stage, both having large operations here in Toronto. Next slide, please. Thank you. So this is, you know, for a company looking to cross the pond from Europe into North America, you know, many of, you know, you and others have their eyes set on, you know, major cities of the US, San Francisco, New York, Boston, Chicago, you name it. And one of the things that I'm tasked to do is really bring Toronto top of mind of decision makers and business leaders. We're looking to do exactly that, to build a new market, build a new base in North America. And so we do compete quite heavily with, you know, US cities and Canadian ones for that matter. And it's important to put Toronto in context with that, right? When we talk about market access, you know, Canada is the only G7 country to have free trade agreements with every other G7 country, which and it allows easy access to the US market. In terms of the workforce, we have the fastest growing tech talent pool of all major North American tech hubs. More than 250,000 international students come to study in Canada each year, with nearly half of them in the province of Ontario. When it comes to immigration and business visa, we have, barring COVID, and this will recover. We welcome 100,000 new immigrants every year into Toronto. We're also one of the most diverse places in the world, with 50% of our population being foreign-born. When we talk about cost and benefit analysis, we have the lowest tax rate on new business investment on the G7. And generally speaking, business costs are lower here relative to the U.S. And we talked about this briefly. We have the soundest banking system amongst the G7 countries, and we also have something that's very, very common in Europe, is a universal healthcare. Next slide, please. Thank you. This chart really shows you where Toronto lies in terms of labor quality and labor cost. As you can see on the bottom right, we have really high labor quality at a much lower cost than some of the other major cities in the United States. So this can make quite a bit of a difference when it comes to the bottom line of a company looking to expand into North America. The cost of living is also lower in the Toronto region compared to other tech cities. Apartment rental costs, find are roughly half of those found in the Bay Area. And I think that was my last slide, or second last slide. If you could move to the next slide, please. So that this is my contact information. I'm really here to help companies that are interested in exploring a potential expansion into the Toronto region. One of the things I didn't mention was, we are government funded. We're not for profit. We don't charge for any of our services. I'm happy to talk to you if you're interested in learning more about potentially expanding into the Toronto region, and I'd love to be able to answer your questions, and feel free to reach out to me. That's my contact information, but Michael can also share that later on. That's it for me. Thanks, Michael.
Thanks so much, Salman. That was brilliant and a great run through on everything that's going on here in Toronto. I would echo that Salman and his team are a great source of support. So we're now going to have Alex from the Canadian Bankers Association, who's going to present an overview of the Canadian banking sector. So you're very welcome. I'll hand over to you, Alex. Thank you.
Hi, good morning and good afternoon, everyone. My name is Alex Ciappara. I'm Director of Credit Markets and Economic Policy at the Canadian Bankers Association. And it's a pleasure to be speaking to you all today, where I'll be providing you with an overview of the Canadian banking sector, give you a flavor as to some of its strengths, some of its features, and its role in the technological landscape. But first, who is the CBA? Who is the Canadian Bankers Association? We are a professional industry association that provides our members, which are the Chartered Banks of Canada, with advocacy, information, research, and operational support. We advocate for public policies that contribute to a sound, thriving banking system. We were established in 1891. We represent over 60 domestic and foreign banks in Canada. We have a head office in Toronto, which is the commercial capital city of the country, with regional offices in Ottawa and Montreal, Ottawa being the administrative capital of Canada, and Montreal being the commercial capital of Quebec. We're fully funded by our members. We've got no government support. We are a trade association, and we do lobby the government on behalf of the banking industry. One feature of the Canadian banking system is this balance of stability and competition. On the stability and soundness side, you've seen that the World Economic Forum has ranked Canada's banking system as the most sound in the world for 8 years in a row. Coming out of the global financial crisis, we are the most sound in the G7 still. What you've seen in the last couple of years is a number of banks have made their banking systems more Canadian, and I'll get back to that a little bit later in the presentation. Canadian banks received no government bailouts during the global financial crisis, and there have been only two bank failures in close to 100 years in Canada, and those two happened in 1985 as a result of the fall of fallen oil prices in the 1980s. On the other side, we've also got a lot of competition and innovation in the banking system amongst banks and with other financial institutions. amongst banks, Capgemini used to report on the customer experience index in their World Retail Banking report, and they ranked Canada first out of 32 countries between 2012 and 2016. We've got over 80 banks in Canada, in addition to other financial institutions, and over 40 of these banks provide affordable, accessible products and services, and a variety of products and services to retail and small business customers through a variety of channels. Canadians are increasingly comfortable with using technology in their interactions with the banking system. In a survey that the Canadian Bankers Association undertook a couple years ago, we learned that 91% of Canadians believe that banking has become a lot more convenient because of new technology. And we've also learned that 76% of Canadians do most of their banking digitally using online and mobile banking. We've got a tremendous amount of competition amongst Canadian banks. You'll often hear when referencing the Canadian banking system of the Big Six. These are the Big Six. All six of these banks are domestic systemically important banks, two of which are considered G-SIBs, global systemically important banks. We also have regional banks that are expanding and growing their presence across their country. We've got banks that specialize in lending to mortgages. We've got virtual and online banks with their platform being largely online. We've got banks that are owned by grocery stores and department stores. We've got banks that are affiliated with credit unions. I believe in the UK, the equivalent would be building trusts. We've got banks that are credit card banks that are foreign subsidiaries and foreign bank branches. And all these banks compete with other financial institutions, some of which Salman had highlighted in his presentation, like credit unions and Caisse Populaire, life and health insurers, property and casualty insurers, crown corporations that are government owned, FinTechs, among a host of other financial institutions. There are some economic benefits of a strong, stable banking system. Here are a few. Banks paid $12.7 billion in taxes to all levels of government in Canada. They've paid $21.3 billion in dividends. They account for about 3.5% of Canada's GDP and employ about 280,000 Canadians, not to mention individuals that are employed in banks' global operations in other parts of the world. Canadian banks also spent $14 billion in technology in 2018 and have spent over $100 billion in technology over the past decade. Some of the characteristics of the Canadian banking system are the following. And I should say this is a critical slide because the rest of the presentation will demonstrate these points. The first point is around a national banking system. You only need one charter to operate a banking license across the country. So if you get that charter, you can operate in any part of the country. Secondly, Canadian banks have their business model is a universal banking model, but one with retail banking at its core. And there's a lot of benefits to this, which I'll get to in a moment. And lastly, Canadian banks benefit from a robust supervisory and regulatory structure and practice. And Canadian banks are federally regulated. And again, I'll get to that in a moment. First, the national banking coverage. We have banking operations right across the country. Each of the six largest banks have branches, ABMs, operations in each one of the 10 provinces of the country. This gives you a flavor of the amount of branches and ABMs that banks have across the country. As I mentioned, banks, once they get their license, are able to operate their banking business in all provinces and territories of the country with no additional banking license required. Because of this national banking system, seen on the prior slide, banks are able to move their liquidity around the country easily and diversify their risk. This graph right here demonstrates that there is a surplus of deposits in Ontario, and banks are then able to take that surplus of deposits in Ontario and move them around to other parts of the country where there's a greater business need. Deposits are not locked into any one province or any one jurisdiction of the country. This is an early feature of Canadian banking. In contrast to the United States, which when they first established the banking system, legislators were very suspicious of large institutions and required state-by-state licenses, which limited the size of banks. This explains why you had close to 18,000 banks in the United States in the 1980s. Now that's down to 6,000, still a large number of banks in the United States. Canadian banks have strong trusted brands. They're amongst the strongest in the country. They're known to be stable, trustworthy, and internationally reputable. Banks have branches and ABMs and operations across the country. They're ubiquitous. And they have consistent service in all channels. In the digital era, this trust can't be overstated. It underpins the fundamentals of banking, a great customer experience, strong prudential oversight, and a dedication to protecting privacy and data. Moving on. On an earlier slide, I showed you that banks have operations across the provinces and across Canada. Canadian banks also have are able to diversify their risk through geographic diversification, not just within Canada, but outside of Canada. About 60% of geographic revenues occur in Canada. Another quarter of those revenues are obtained from the United States, and another 17 are obtained from global operations outside of the United States. Banks also benefit from business line diversification. As mentioned, banks have rely on a universal banking model with retail banking at its core. I was speaking about the diversification of revenues and the fact that banks have been able to rely on size and scale to diversify their risk. And here's another example of that. This chart came from the IMF's FSAP report on Canada, and it demonstrates the Canadian banks' business models, which again is sort of universal banking, an ability to participate in numerous different financial services, but with traditional retail banking at its core. The yellow circles represent Canadian banks, and the blue circles represent globally systemically important banks. And the x-axis highlights the proportion of customer deposits, which tend to be a bit stickier. And you'll see that Canadian banks are on the right-hand side of the chart, and thus rely on a greater degree than other global banks for customer deposits for funding. On the left-hand side, the y-axis, it measures the proportion of revenues that come from non-interest income in the form of, say, investment banking fees and what investment management fees, as opposed to, say, interest spread, which is your sort of pure vanilla, plain vanilla type of banking. And Canadian banks land in the middle of that. It's about 50-50, again, demonstrating sort of diversification revenues. Canadian banks do have a history of extending credit to those who have the capacity to repay their loans. And this chart looks at mortgage delinquency in the US, the UK, the UK, and Canada. I chose mortgages because it's typically the largest that was a source of many problems globally in the global financial crisis. And you see how flat the mortgage arrears rate, the mortgage delinquency rate is for Canada. For instance, during the global financial crisis, it peaked at 0.45%. In contrast, in the United States, that was closer to 5%. And so 13 times that. Now coming out of COVID, the mortgage delinquency rate in Canada is about 0.22%, quite low. And this is a result of a combination of mortgage deferrals, low interest rates, and government COVID relief. And you'll see the UK is somewhere in the middle there between the US and the UK. You've seen you've seen Hugh and Alan talk about, or Adam talk about and reference OSCE, and so did Paul. Canada is a federally regulated a federal state. We have two levels of government. The federal level of government, located in Ottawa, deals with matters of national importance, including banking, whereas provincial levels of government deals with healthcare, education. So banks are federally regulated, and they have single points of contact within the federal government with respect to policy making, which is made by the Department of Finance. You've heard the acronym OSFI, that's the Office of the Superintendent of Financial Institutions. They are the prudential regulator. There's also, and they make regulations and come up with regulations such as B10 that was referenced earlier. There's also the Canada Deposit Insurance Corporation, which deals with deposit insurance. FCAC deals with market conduct and consumer issues, and FinTech, which deals with financial intelligence. In Canada, securities regulation is the outlier, and it's dealt with at the provincial level. I heard reference to credit unions. They are one of the financials, one type of financial institutions that banks compete with. They are, for the most part, provincially regulated as well, and have rely on provincial regulation. Moving on, Canadian bank capital levels are quite high. The Canadian bank capital greatly exceeds those of OSFI. OSFI sets regulatory capital minimums, and you'll see here that Canadian banks vastly exceed the capital levels of minimum capital requirements of OSFI. The economic fallout of COVID-19 has meant that dividend increases and stock buybacks have been put on hold by OSFI, and that has allowed banks to increase their capital buffers. Just in case, banks would run into difficulties lending to businesses and households because of the COVID crisis, but fortunately that has not occurred. And right now banks have in excess of $70 billion in capital reserves in comparison to the capital minimum capital requirements. Moving on, I made a comment early on in the presentation that global banks look more Canadian after the financial crisis. And this is an example of that. Going into the financial crisis, Canadian banks were conservatively levered around 20 times earnings, whereas US investment banks, European banks, and UK banks were higher, anywhere between, say, 23 and 30 times earnings. As a result of sort of global regulatory agreement and changed business practices, you've seen banks globally move their leverage ratios much closer to the Canadian standard going into the crisis. So this leads to my comment that global banks look more Canadian after the financial crisis and going into COVID-19. Lastly, I want to talk about banks and financial technology. You've heard from some of the experts talking about fintech innovations in the banking industry. Banks are always looking out at how to increase choice and improve convenience for customers. They do this through innovative financial technologies, allocating a portion of the $100 billion dedicated to technology in the last decade to do this. And they do this in any number of ways. They do this through in-house development of new technologies. They do this through technology sourced from or developed in partnership with the fintech community. And they also do this in partnership with tech incubators in collaboration with the fintech community. I'm going to drop in the chat a link to a website that the CBA has on innovation in banking, and it gives you an update And it gives you a sense in terms of where banks have been making improvements and investments in technology and innovation. And it's just a quite an extensive list. So I'll finish by concluding that the Canadian banking system strikes a balance between stability and soundness and competition and innovation. Like I mentioned, no government bailouts during the global financial crisis. It's also highly accessible, affordable, and offers tremendous choice. It also relies on sort of three characteristics of the Canadian banking system, which is one that is national, one that is a universal banking model with traditional retail banking at its core, and one that relies on robust supervisory and regulatory structures and practices. And banks are now using technology to help manage risk and improve the customer experience. And with that, I'll turn it back over to Michael.